now with more and more droughts and floods from warming of the earth, there's no choice. Countries have got to work together, or else they will not have the water in the rivers or lakes, or they will draw down all the water from the aquifers, or they'll deplete all the fisheries. So all the countries work together to put the information together. So how about Lake Victoria? There's a lake, and then there's the basin that might drain to the lake. And you have Kenya over here, and you have Uganda over here, and you have Tanzania over here, and you have Rwanda and Burundi in this large basin with rivers coming in and the lake all stirring together. The countries put their information together in a first GEF project, and they found that the lake is really threatened by several things. It's threatened by an invasive species, water hyacinth, that actually started in lakes up here in Rwanda and Burundi from the people from other countries who lived there and introduced it from South America. So it comes down into the lake and finds a nice habitat and actually prevents boats from going back and forth. It prevents the fishermen from getting out from all the different communities to catch the fish. And it uses up oxygen in the lake. We also found in the bigger towns around the lake, such as in Uganda here, with Entebbe and Kampala, the capital, and here in Kenya and Kisumu and Mwanza in Tanzania, that there's a great deal of pollution from sewage. Human sewage is just not treated. So it adds to oxygen-demanding material and nutrients here that make too much algae. So the algae grows, and it then dies, and it sucks out the oxygen when it dies as the bacteria eat it, and then the fish die off. Back in the 1990s, this was a $500 million export fishery to Europe for Nile perch. That's one of the other transboundary concerns here, that the British introduced a fish that wasn't native here in, I guess, the 1950s. So the Nile perch has actually dominated the lake, and it's eaten up all the little fish that are really important for biodiversity and were important for the people around the lake and the villages to eat. They used to eat the smaller fish, and now all there is Nile perch. So investors came in the 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s and started this export fishery. So back in the 90s, hunger is back here in Lake Victoria, because the poor people, if they catch a Nile perch, they have to send it to the processing plant for a livelihood for them instead of eating the fish, and the fish that they eat aren't there anymore. So transboundary concerns relate to the sewage that's creating a problem. Fertilizers, Kenya, if you've driven from Kenya to Uganda or Kenya to Tanzania, it's like night and day. Kenya's a lot richer than the others. So they use subsidized fertilizer here in the Kisumu area. And this embayment of Lake Victoria is green and full of plants and just blooming like crazy, helping to ruin, and the fish die there. So it's the only place where the fertilizer is an issue. So there you go. That is what the countries put together, that we have a transboundary problem from the overfishing and the new type of fish that are there, of the weeds, and we have a transboundary problem from pollution, from fertilizers here in Kenya, and then sewage pollution in the other three big towns. And the lake kind of goes like this, so it's kind of stirred around. And then they found one other thing with the GEF project that was shocking to everybody, and that is that phosphorus is an important nutrient for freshwater systems, that burning in Africa, slash and burn, makes the vegetation get burned, and the ash that goes up into the air has a lot of phosphorus in it. And places that have big surface areas like this, the burning, the phosphorus comes down and helps fertilize along with the human sewage. So this shows us that There are connections between the land degradation focal area of GEF, have less burning, so there's less fertilizer come in. It also has other things like there are important wetlands here that can stop pollution. If they could only be made into parks through the biodiversity area, that could help stop the pollution, in some places be restored. And the other thing is that there are small lakes, little satellite lakes around here, that have some of the biodiversity left that the Nile perch wasn't able to get through the vegetation or the barrier. So you still have some of the genetic stock left of those little fish that are only at home is Lake Victoria. So desperately needed biodiversity projects to protect this source of genetic material, and that just hasn't happened. We haven't had much luck in getting the land degradation area to deal with the burning, nor the biodiversity area to deal with this. It's all been international waters money, three separate projects to Lake Victoria. But the catalytic impact here has been that the countries have seen that this is a big problem, so they have actually created by treaty a fisheries organization in the first GEF International Waters Project with a fisheries treaty to try to figure out how to sustain this fishery. It's maybe $400 million now, so it's still very important for livelihoods. So that's very good. They said they need to put together a commission and a treaty for the basin management. So they actually took an existing treaty of the East African Community and put a protocol to that, creating the Lake Victoria Basin Commission, which is now working on our last GEF project there, which has $100 million from the World Bank and has a commitment from Sweden for probably another $100 million over a 10-year period. So we've kind of set it up so it's ready to sustain itself. The institutions have been created. Assistance is there through other organizations, not GEF. And that's our GEF International Waters strategy. Have a catalytic impact. Try to help create institutions, put some demonstration projects on the ground, and then move on to another place that needs it, and let the other development institutions continue on. In this case, we were really also pleased because the weed problem had to be handled by the two French-speaking countries in the basin, Rwanda and Burundi from Central Africa that are part of the basin. So they decided to join the East African Community. So they signed and ratified the East African Community Treaty and the protocol. So now all five countries are in that Lake Victoria Basin Commission, ready to work together. They do things bilingually. It's just really, really exciting to see. So those are some of the catalytic things that GEF has done. That's our strategy to catalyze something and let others take over as we move on to other things. If we had more money in international waters, we could stay longer in places. But now the strategy that was developed in 1995 is just try to set things in order. GEF and our agencies kind of being the orchestra leader, and then having other organizations for development assistance come in afterwards, demonstrate that they work with our money, and then let the completion of dealing with all the sector reforms go to regional development banks or other funds. So that's the illustration of the transboundary diagnostic, which led to the action program, which led to two treaties, and now into implementation with hundreds of millions of dollars of assistance. And our GEF part is only a little $5 million, hundreds of millions by the people.